So I greet you in the precious name of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Thank God for giving us once again an opportunity to study the book of Hosea. So we have been studying the book of Hosea in the overall theme of covenant signs. So the book of Hosea, so far, we have seen different signs of the covenant. So as I have said earlier, through the prophet Hosea, God is reminding the people of Israel, the people of God, the covenant relationship to which God has called them. And through that, he also shows his faithfulness in that covenant relationship. And God is calling them to that kind of a mutual relationship in that covenant, to be faithful, to be loyal, to be steadfast in that covenant relationship. And through the 14 chapters of the book of Hosea, so we will be meditating on the different signs which shows the covenant and how God not only reminds them of the covenant, but he also calls them to come back to that covenant. So we have been studying on the different signs. And one of the significant thing that we need to understand is the Hebrew word hesed, which talks about the depth of the love of God, how it is faithful, how it is loyal, how God continuously, steadfastly, he shows his love, his mercy, his compassion towards us. And as we understand his love, as we understand his faithfulness, we will also will begin to reflect his character, his attributes. And I wish and pray that even as we continue to study all these chapters, God will restore us back to that covenant relationship. And today, we will be studying the sixth chapter of Hosea in the title, Signs of a Revival. Or I would say, Signs of a Revived Life. That is, when God revives, how does a person's life look like? So let me read a couple of verses. Chapter 6 and verse 2 and 3, the beginning of the third verse. After 2 days, he will revive us. On the third day, he will raise us up that we may live before him. Let us press on to know the Lord. So here, in the sixth chapter, we see how does a life look like that which has been revived by God. And here in this sixth chapter, you also see where God shows us that we have broken a covenant. There are a few chapters here where you can also see that God specifically talking about certain covenants. And here in the sixth chapter, God talks about one of the covenants that people have broken. Look at the seventh verse. But at Adam, they transgressed the covenant. There, they dealt faithlessly with me. So God says here that they transgressed the covenant at Adam. So God is actually, reminding them of what happened or what occurred in the Garden of Eden. We see that, right? So there was a covenant that was broken there. What covenant was broken there? He made Adam and Eve to have a close relationship with him, for them to be in his presence. Secondly, he also had given them a commandment. He had given them an instruction, a command, which he didn't want them to break. So because they broke his word, because they broke his commandment, what did that lead to? It led them to break that covenant relationship with God. So if you remember what happened in the Eden Garden, in Genesis, in the early chapters, that after they broke the covenant, and when God comes in the evening to have fellowship with Adam and Eve, instead of having the courage to go and meet with God, they went and hid themselves. That is what happens as a consequence. What is the consequence when we break the covenant of obeying God's commandment, obeying God's word? It affects our relationship with God. It's directly related. That is what God is reminding the people here, that even like Adam, when you break this covenant relationship by disobeying my commandments, by disobeying my word, failing to walk according to my word, you cannot have a meaningful relationship with me, a true relationship with me. So that is how, you know, we understand. So this chapter very much focuses on renewing that relationship with God. And it shows how a life that which has been truly revived by God would look like. So so look at the beginning of the third verse. Once again, let us press on to know the Lord. So there is an element of pursuit, you know, that which is actually shown here, to press on. So in today's meditation, I will use these two words, press on, for us to understand the different signs of a revived life. So I will present five signs of a revived life using the word press, you know, P-R-E-S-S. And then I will close with the two other signs from the word on. So that's how our today's meditation will be. So let me take you quickly to the very first sign of a revival or a revived life. It is to pursue God. Look at the third and the sixth verse. Third verse, let us press on to know the Lord. His appearing is as sure as the dawn. He will come to us like the showers, like the spring rains that water the earth. The sixth verse, for I desire steadfast love and not sacrifice, the knowledge of God rather than burnt offerings. So what is the very first sign of a revived life look like? What is the very first sign of a reconciled life with God looks like? It is, you know, it is the pursuit of God. That is, a person who has been revived in his relationship with God, how will his life look like? He will want to know God more. Now, there will be a thirst after God, after the knowledge of God, after the knowledge of God's word. Amen. That thirst will be there. See, that's why this, the third verse, which says, let us press on to know the Lord. It goes on to talks about God is appearing, you know, the appearance of God is as sure as the dawn. He will come to us like the showers, like the spring rains that water the earth. You know, on one side, God does, you know, give us his presence. He reveals unto us. But the question is, you know, are we like a thirsty earth? You know, the rain can come down, but is the earth willing to receive that rain? You know, if the rain is not willing to receive the rain, what use? That is why, that is the kind of an allegory, you know, this prophet is employing here. He's saying that his appearance is as sure as the dawn. He will come to us like the showers, like the spring rains that water the earth. You know, so how does a revived life look like? That life will be like that, you know, that earth, that which is yearning to receive the rains. There will be a thirst after God. There will be a thirst after the word of God. So the first sign is to pursue God. That's why, you know, John chapter 17 and verse 3. Look at John chapter 17 and verse 3. What does Jesus say there? This is the eternal life. What is eternal life? That they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. So what is eternal life itself? It is to know God, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom the Father has sent. That's what Jesus said. This is what eternal life looks like. Now, the pursuit of God is part of the eternal life. And that's why, you know, when we read Matthew chapter 16, where Jesus takes his disciples to the district of Caesarea Philippi, and he asks them this question. What does he ask them this question? In the 13th verse of the 16th chapter in Matthew's Gospel, who do people say that the Son of Man is? He was asking them this question. Who do people say I am? So they went on to give a lot of answers. But I want you to look at the 15th verse. What is Jesus is more interested here is, he said to them, but who do you say that I am? You know, he's asking this question to the disciples, but who do you say that I am. That is, do you really know me? That's what Jesus is asking them. So her life, that which is truly revived, you know, when truly revived in the covenant relationship with God, will pursue God. So there will be a thirst after God and his knowledge. Let me, you know, show the condition of today's world and the church from a quote from A.W. Tozer. What does he say? The world is perishing for lack of the knowledge of God, and the church is famishing for want of his presence. How true this is. You know, the world is perishing. Why the world is perishing? For the lack of the knowledge of God. Because the world doesn't know the true living God. The world doesn't know that eternal life is through his son, Jesus Christ. That's why the world is perishing. And the church is famishing for want of his presence. As I said earlier, like the dawn, like the showers of the rain, God's presence, God's knowledge is always there for us. But are we truly thirsting after God? Are we truly pursuing after God? That is the, you know, very first sign of a revived life. You know, I cannot overstate this. But, you know, this is how true this is. Now, may the Lord give you and me that kind of a passion, you know, to pursue after God, to pursue after God's word. Now, how much do we, if we truly thirst, you know, our days will begin and end in God's presence, in prayer, in praising God, in studying his word. It will always be after the word of God. You know, if you remember in the previous chapter where we meditated about returning to God and seeking after him, you know, I showed the life of that businessman, Lot Tornow. You know, he was quite a famous businessman, an inventor with 300 patents. With all of that, you know, his priority was pursuing God. How he would read the word of God at his workplace. He was so successful in his business, yet, you know, he prioritized seeking God. May the Lord give us that kind of a life. Second sign of a revived life is to return repented. So a true repentance is the sign of a revived life. Look at the first verse here. Come, let us return to the Lord, for it is he who has torn and he will heal us. He has struck down and he will bind us up. So what is it, you know, the prophet is saying here? You know, he is reminding the people of God's discipline. You know, and his response to the discipline of God. Now, when God disciplines, two kind of a response can actually, you know, happen in our life. So we can give two different types of responses. One is either we can rebel or we can repent and return. Only two responses. You know, either we can rebel against God, against God's word, again the counsel of God, or we can truly return and repent and return to God. So here, you know, the prophet is saying, if we are revived by God, if we have commit ourselves to a true revival, what happens? You know, we will say, let us return to the Lord, for it is he who has torn and he will heal us. He has struck down and he will bind us up. You know, so there is this true repentance and returning to God. When you look at, you know, God's discipline, so there is no element of rebellion here, but there is only an element of returning back to God. You know, may the Lord help us understand this. You know, the Hebrew, the writer of Hebrew, when he talks about this disciplining of God, we did, you know, meditate upon that in a few chapters earlier, on how the Hebrew writer says is that like a father, like a parent who disciplines the child, God disciplines his children, you and me, you know. And when we go through that discipline, it is painful. It is not pleasurable. But when we come out of that discipline, there is the fruit of righteousness. Amen. So when we go through that, it could be painful. But when we come out, we receive the fruit of righteousness. So that's the second sign, a true heart of repentance, of returning back to God. We have, in fact, in the last chapter, we studied the whole chapter on the signs of, you know, returning to God. And may the Lord help us to truly return to Him. The third sign of a revived life is to ensure faithfulness. Look at verse 7 to 9. Let me read the verses. But at Adam they transgressed the covenant. There they dealt faithlessly with me. Gilead is a city of evildoers, trackled with blood. As robbers lie in wait for someone, so the priests are banded together. They murder on the road to Shechem. They commit a monstrous crime. So here it talks about the lack of faithfulness on part of the people and part of the priests. What is that lack of faithfulness here? One is they have dealt unfaithful with God. So when we, you know, truly return to God, when our lives are truly revived, there is faithfulness. What is faithfulness? How does faithfulness look like? When we give our whole heart, we give our whole self to God. Now that is the demonstration of faithfulness. When there is faithfulness, it is no more us, it is only God. Our whole heart is given to God. Now our whole person is given to God. So we don't deal faithlessly with God. We don't deal unfaithfully with God. And how does it look like? The 8th verse and the 9th verse say, because they were unfaithful, no, they became evil. They became evildoers. No, they became a priest who are banded together, who rob and murder. No, these very strong words are used there. So what is it actually, what is God is saying? Who is a priest here? The priest is called to serve God so that, you know, they may teach people so that their lives can be mended, so that they can come in a relationship with God. On the contrary, you know, the priest is, because he is unfaithful, he is abusing, you know, the ministry that which is given to him or her. That's what God is saying here. So we need to be very careful. So when we, you know, when our lives are truly revived, how does it look like? There is faithfulness there. Let me also read a verse from what Paul the Apostle writes in 1 Corinthians for us to understand faithfulness. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12 to 14. Look at the verse 12 to 14. So if you think you are standing, watch out that you do not fall. No testing has overtaken you that is not common to everyone. God is faithful, and He will not let you be tested beyond your strength. But with the testing, He will also provide the way out so that you may be able to endure it. Therefore, my dear friends, flee. So, in fact, we look at the context of the 10th chapter of 1 Corinthians. It talks about several, you know, areas of unfaithfulness. For example, if you look at the 8th verse of the same chapter, it says, we must not indulge in sexual immorality. And look at the 9th verse, we must not put Christ to the test. And look at the 10th verse, and do not complain, as some of them did. And look at the 14th verse, flee from the worship of idols. No, Sarah, all of these are elements of unfaithfulness. If you're not faithful, how does that life look like? There is sexual immorality. You know, Christ has been put to test. There is complaining. There is, you know, worship of idols, or, you know, and not only idols, but even people are made as an, you know, like an idol, idolatry, a worship of men is there, people is there. So these all are elements of unfaithfulness. But what is Paul the Apostle is actually, you know, showing us there? The 13th verse is, God is faithful. But the question is, am I faithful? And how much God is faithful? He will not let you be tested beyond your strength. But with the testing, He will also provide the way out so that you may be able to endure it. On one side, we are tested. But along with the test, God is also giving a way out. All that we need to do is, you know, to hold on to that way out and be faithful with God. So this faithfulness, a faithful life to God, faithful life in our relationship is an sign of a revived life. You know, may the Lord help us to be always faithful, to be faithful with God, to be faithful to our spouses, to be faithful in all the relationship to which God has called us. And the next sign of a revived life is steadfast love. Verse 4 to 6, let me read those verses. What shall I do with you, O Ephraim? What shall I do with you, O Judah? Your love is like a morning cloud, like the dew that goes away early. Therefore I have wounded them by the prophets. I have killed them by the words of my mouth. And my judgment goes forth as the light. For I desire steadfast love and not sacrifice, the knowledge of God rather than burnt offerings. So the fourth sign of a revived life is steadfast love. What is steadfast love? You know, I think no one else can explain it better than how Prophet Hosea says here regarding our love for God. He says, your love is like a morning cloud, like the dew that goes away early. What is it? What does he say? It is a very, you know, that a love that is not long lasting. It just goes away very early. You know, sometimes a love for God can only be a feeling. What happens when your mood changes, when circumstances changes, you know, when you face with some kind of a trouble and challenge, your love can diminish. Is a love like that? We need to test ourselves. But if a life is truly revived, our life will not be like the morning dew. You know, what does the morning dew, what does it happen to the morning dew? As soon as, you know, as the sun rises up, goes up, the heat of the day, it is gone. It's there only, you know, for some time. Now, sometimes the love for God can be like that. Early in the morning, good to rise up and praise God. But, and are we leaving a love for God, you know, only with that praise in the morning? Is it over with that? You know, sometimes we may think, oh yes, I have praised God, I have worshipped God in the morning. Yes, I have done. You know, I have ticked that requirement. It is not so. If I have the true love for God, it has to be there the whole day. What does it mean? In fact, the true love comes when we step out of a prayer. Right? After we step out of a prayer in the morning, as we go through the whole day, you know, our life has to demonstrate our love for God. How can we demonstrate the love for God through the day? Jesus beautifully says, if you love me, you will keep my word. You will obey my commandments. So day in and day out, do we, you know, have that heart to obey God's word, to walk according to God's commandments in all areas of life? You know, we can make mistakes. You know, some mistakes might happen, but on the contrary, do we have that intention? Do we have that, you know, that yearning? As I said earlier, you know, the pursuit of God, you know, the passion to know God is a sign. The same way, a passion, a thirst to obey God and to love Him. You know, that is why, you know, we know that, right, that when we discipline our children, we always say this, right, that if you love me, you will obey my words. You know, I say this to my son, that if you truly love me, you will obey daddy. That's what God is also saying. You know, it's very simple to understand, but sometimes we may struggle with that. But if our life is truly revived, you know, what happens, you know, we actually get into a different frequency. That is what this is. You know, loving God out of compulsion is difficult, but obeying God after compulsion is difficult, but obeying God out of love is easy. Now let me repeat that. You know, obeying God out of compulsion, out of duty is very difficult, which many Christians, you know, they do it religiously. But what is actually God is calling to in this covenant relationship is to obey Him out of love. So if we truly love Him, we will actually obey Him. So the element of love is predominant, is significant. That is what, you know, he says. And again, look at what John the Apostle says in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 19. What does he say? We love because he first loved us. Amen. Again, you know, here, where is the example of love? How do we love? Because he first loved us. Now, we are only reciprocating this love. And if we know that God loves us, and if we are completely, you know, captivated by his love, it will not be difficult to love him by obeying his word, obeying his commandments, by walking in his word day in and day out. May the Lord help us, you know, to have a steadfast love, not that love that is up and down based on our feelings or circumstances, you know, but steadfast, always the same. The last sign of a revived life is sanctified life. Look at the 10th verse. In the house of Israel, I have seen a horrible thing. Ephraim's whoredom is there. Israel is defiled. So when there is a lack of revival in our lives, there is defilement. There is unholiness. You know, there is everything, you know, filth, everything is there. But when our lives are revived by God, holiness is there. You know, sanctity is demonstrated. Let me read what Apostle Peter writes in 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 15 and 16. What does he say there? Like obedient children, do not be conformed to the desires that you formerly had in ignorance. Instead, as he who called you is holy, be holy yourselves in all your conduct. For it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. Once again, you know, can you see that? Is all of these are characters and attributes of God himself. That's what Peter says. He's reminding the people from the Old Testament text, for you shall be holy, for I am holy. As he who called you is holy, be holy yourselves in all your conduct. So like obedient children, do not be conformed to the desires that you formerly had in ignorance. So again, it comes to the knowledge of God. When we did not know God, when we were in ignorance, what did we do? We conformed our actions according to the desires of the world. But now, because we know God, because we know God's word, we know that our God is a holy God, what do? We strive to be holy in all of our conduct because our God is holy. So holiness, sanctity is a demonstration of a revived life. So today we have looked at, you know, these five signs of a revived life. So let me summarize and close. One, if a life is truly revived, there will be a pursuit of God. We will thirst after God. We will thirst after the knowledge of God. Second, we will not rebel against God's discipline. Rather, we will repent and return to God. Now, we will do exactly what God requires out of us. Thirdly, our life will demonstrate faithfulness towards God and also in all of our relationships. And there will be a steadfast love towards God. And finally, our lives will demonstrate a sanctified life, you know, a holiness and sanctity. Once again, you know, as we have gone through this meditation, I want to remind you, what did we actually study in the 6th chapter? When you looked at sanctified life, we saw that God is holy. When we looked at steadfast love, you know, we saw that it is he who has loved us first. When we looked at faithfulness, we saw that God is faithful. What do we see in all these areas is, you know, it is all we learn from God as we know God. So the prime element, you know, the most important element area is pursuit of God. As we pursue God, we understand his character. We understand his attributes. And even as the more we understand, what happens is we will want to repent and return back to him. And what will happen as a consequence, we will grow in all those areas. And the sixth chapter not only shows these, it also shows the reward for that. That's what the 11th verse talks about. Look at the 11th verse. For you also with Judah, a harvest is appointed when I would restore the fortunes of my people. So there are two things that we see there: ordained harvest and a new inheritance. Amen. So the chapter closes with a blessing. And harvest, that which is appointed, ordained for you, and then renewed inheritance, a restored fortune is kept for you. So let us press on. Let me close with a quote and also a life of A.W. Tozer, an American Christian preacher, an evangelist, an author, and a pastor. Let me read this first. Before I get into the quote, let me quickly talk about his life. A.W. Tozer is very well known for one of his most famous works called The Pursuit of God. A wonderful book. I would really recommend you to read that book. It will be truly a blessing to know the different elements of pursuing God. And before he came to Christ, his life was wayward. And when his life was wayward, there was one time he was with his sister. He had climbed an apple tree, and he was singing this song on the apple tree, saying, "Is there any room in heaven for a lad like me?" He thought that for this kind of a life, there is no room in heaven. But someone responded to him. What did they respond? "If there is going to be any room for you in heaven, you will have to mend your ways." Those words were very sharp. That you mend your ways, you will have a room for heaven. And very shortly, when Tozer was walking by the street, he heard a preacher. And he went to that meeting. He listened to the preacher. Right after that meeting, he went home, climbed the attic. That same evening, he gave his life to Christ. God had turned his life so much, revived his life so much, that he went on to minister God for 44 years. And through his life, he touched thousands and thousands of people. And even today, though he is no more, his books and his sermons truly revive people. But when this is what I want you to look at, how did this changed life, this transformed life, the revived life of A.W. Tozer look like? As a youth, he was inclined to be cynical. But as time passed, tempered by the soft breezes of the Spirit, his doubts were replaced by unshakable Christian faith. Gradually, day by day, cynicism gave way to faith, and kindness and consideration displaced a quarrelsome and argumentative spirit. What do you see there? That is cynical, his hard temperament, his quarrelsome and argumentative spirit, they all were replaced with kindness and consideration. So that's a sign of a revived life. When he talks about his revived life, he says, character must be molded by experience. Growth in grace and the knowledge of God must come. This is what A.W. Tozer himself says. When our life is truly revived, what does he say? That growth in grace and the knowledge of God must come. So let me close with one of his quotes from this book, The Pursuit of God. Beautifully, he says, "Millions call themselves by his name, it is true, and pay some token homage to him. But a simple test will show how little he is really honored among them." What is the test? Let the average man be put to the proof on the question of who or what is above, and his true position will be exposed. Let him be forced into making a choice between God and money, between God and men, between God and personal ambition, God and self, God and human love, and God will take second place every time. Those other things will be exalted above. How true this is. No, let us put the simple test to our own lives. We do call upon his name. But when we put this test to our life, what is above? Let us be forced into making a choice. When we are forced into making this choice between God and money, between God and men, between God and our personal ambition, between God and ourselves, between God and our human love, does will God take the first place, or do these things, money, men, personal ambition, self, human love, will these take the first place? Now, that is the test that you and me need to be put to. Even as we meditated today on the sixth chapter of Hosea, and also looked at the life of A.W. Tozer, you know, may the Lord help us to truly pursue Him. If we truly pursue Him, you know, we have seen the signs of a truly revived life. You know, may the Lord help us to not truly pursue Him and to keep Him as the priority of our life, so that, you know, our pursued, our revived life may bring others to Christ. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you, Lord, for today's meditation, Father, from the book of Hosea. And Lord, we especially pray, O Father, that our life, Lord, would truly, Lord, seek after you. Will, Lord, demonstrate the signs of revival, O Master. That, Lord, that we will thirst after you and your word, O Master. We will pursue you, O Father. Pursuit of you will be our happiness, O God. Will be our priority, O God. Yes, Father, we are like a Lord, let the herd that thirsts after the rain. Let our lives be like that, O Father, like the deer that, Lord, thirsts after the water. Let our lives be like that, O Father. And Lord, let us not rebel against your discipline, but let us, Lord, repent and return back to your Father. Let there be, Lord, faithfulness, Lord, toward you and all the relationship that you've given us, O Father. And Lord, let us grow in your love, O Father, and be steadfast in that. And Lord, let our lives be demonstrate your holiness, sanctity, O Father. Thank you, God. We commit, Lord, all of us into your hands. Let our revive the life. Lord, bring people unto you. Let our lives show you to this world. We give you all the honor and glory. In Jesus' name, Lord, we pray. Amen. Amen.